The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. So the law strengthens sin. Get rid of the law, and sin will be no more. You won't have any, people won't sin anymore because you got rid of the law. And the strength of sin is the law. Without the law, there is no sin. And if there is no sin, there is no grace. Grace doesn't, there's no need for grace. And a lot of people that preach this type of grace, when they hear me saying that we can walk like Christ and can overcome our sin and stop sinning, quit it completely, they like to quote this scripture. It's 1 John 1:8. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Well, when they say that now that they have grace and they have forgiveness through Christ, now God doesn't see their sin. They're washed by the blood. The blood is covering their sins. God only sees Christ when he looks at them. He only sees the righteousness of Christ. Christ's righteousness is counted to them as righteousness. That's what they preach. And they're saying they don't have any sin. That's what they're saying. Because if God doesn't see their sin doesn't exist. Especially when they say the law is gone. Because yes, if there's no law, there's no more sin. They don't have any. But this says if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. Then he says, my little children, these things I write unto you that ye sin not. They teach it's impossible to sin not. They say you can't stop sinning and that's why you need grace. So they've twisted the entire gospel completely. And they're the ones who are saying they don't have sin. Because if their sin is covered by the blood and all their future sins have already been forgiven, they don't exist. They're saying they don't have any sin. It's important to understand how they've twisted this message. They're the ones saying they don't have any sin, not me. I'm not saying I don't have sin, and I'm not saying I never sinned. I'm saying that I can stop sinning through the power of Christ. Otherwise, he was wasting his breath when he said, I write these things so that you sin not. It's common sense, really. If grace is a done deal and it's finished, when you receive grace, when you receive the gospel and accept Jesus Christ, then why did they say continue in grace? It's wasted words. Romans 5:21. That as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. See, grace continues. It reigns on. Keeps on going until salvation, which is the day our bodies are made immortal, eternal life. And that can only happen if there's no sin in us, because sin brings death. And no sinner is going to inherit eternal life. There's scriptures that say that too, by the way. So they say, I'm just a poor sinner saved by grace. I got news for them. The Bible says no sinner is going to inherit eternal life. So in conclusion to what I was saying, if there's no law, the law is dead. Grace is dead. There's no need for it. Where there is no law, there is no sin. And where there is no sin, there's no need for grace. They say then sin is no sin. That's what they're saying. Their sin is no sin at all. It's not sin. And then they make it worse by saying they can't stop sinning. Contrary to the apostles' teachings. Yet true living grace does not come because you can't stop sinning. True living grace comes to make you stop sinning, to bring you to the place of no more sin. Now we're going to discuss a little bit more on this subject of law. They've thrown it out. They said there is no law. The law does not apply to us anymore. That's their exact word. Let's look at 2 Thessalonians 2:8. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. And if you go back into verse 1 of that same chapter, it says,
now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, shewing himself that he is God.
It calls him the lawless one in other translations.
And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. New King James Version.
If law causes sin, like they're preaching, and to preach law causes sin to happen more, then the son of perdition is the man of law, not the lawless one. He's the one of law. That's just common sense. For law causes sin, and this is the man of sin. So he's going to be the man of law, not the man of lawlessness. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for all shall know me from the least to the greatest. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. In that he saith a new, he hath made the first old. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away. Now the translators of the King James and later translators of these verses have made it that the old covenant is old and passing away and gone. And that's not what these verses say. If you look in verse 13, it says a new, they added the word covenant in the King James. That's in italics. It wasn't in the original translation. So it says, when he saith anew, he hath made the first old. That's not talking about the covenant. We got to go back and see. It says, but now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. For if that first, and they added the word covenant there, but it wasn't in the... If that first had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. Now notice in verse 8 it says, For finding fault with them, not the covenant, the fault was in those covenant breakers, those who were supposed to be keeping the covenant. That's where the fault was at, not with the covenant itself. For finding fault with them, he saith, Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Paul wrote Hebrews. A lot of people don't think he did. There's debate on that. But Paul wrote Hebrews, and it's obvious because in verse 13 it says, In that he saith a new, he hath made the first old. And it's not talking about a covenant. It's talking about the people that were keeping the covenant. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away. That's talking about there's a new Israel, a new Jerusalem. He says that in Hebrews, and he says it in Romans, and he says it in Galatians. But the covenant is not dead. In fact, the law is the covenant. The old covenant is the law, and the law is written in our hearts and in our minds under the new covenant. So the new covenant is the old covenant, just administered in a better way, with better promises, by a new and living way which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his own flesh. Okay, let's look at 2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. The modern grace preachers are saying the law is dead. And they go so far as to say, if you want people to sin more, preach law. Well, what is the law? The law are the scriptures. That was the only scriptures they had when these verses I just read were written. They only had the law and the prophets. And the prophets were basically exhortation to follow the law. That's what the prophets of old did. They came to preach to the people of Israel, hey, you're not following God's laws. What about the law? So they were preachers of law. The scriptures themselves, back then when this was written, that was the only scriptures they had, were the law and the prophets, which was also part of the law. So they're saying that if you preach the scriptures, you're going to cause people to sin more. And they want to throw out the scriptures. That's what they want to do, is throw the scriptures right out. And here he says that all scripture is good for reproof and instruction in righteousness. So somebody's got something mixed up, and it's not me. I'll tell you that. And by the way, Yeshua Messiah, Jesus Christ himself, preached law. He told the rich man that the way to eternal life is to keep the commandments. So he was preaching law too. I pointed that out in one of the other tapes. But in John 16, 7 through 8, he says, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away." And that expedient, that word doesn't mean what it means these days. Expedient now means, well, you know, it's a good thing, but not necessary. That's what expedient means. But expedient, this word that was used, means absolutely necessary. "It is expedient for you that I go away, for if I go not away," and he's speaking of his crucifixion here, when he says go away, "if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you, but if I depart, I will send him unto you." Now, he also says, "And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment." Now, if the law is gone and the law is irrelevant, the law is dead now, then how is the Holy Spirit going to reprove the world of sin? Because like I said, the only way there can be sin is if you have the law. But they've thrown it out. The law is no more, according to them. So the Holy Spirit can't reprove the world of sin. That's just common sense. I can't believe they missed that.